Okay, so let's begin. It's my pleasure to present you today, Dr. Luis Arola Fernandez. So Luis did his degree in physics at Universidad de Barcelona in 2015, I think. Mm-hmm. And then he did his master in complex system at Autónoma de Barcelona the next year. Then he went out to work at the industry at the Energy Research Council in Catalonia, mm-hmm, for 1 year. After that, he joined academia again to do a PhD under Alex Arenas at the Universidad Rovira y Virgili around topics on synchronization in complex networks, which is the topic of this talk. And just as an announcement, he recently joined IFISC as a postdoc, maybe 1 month ago or so, and he will be around for 2 years, hopefully more, but let's see. And working on the interface between dynamical systems, temporal networks, machine learning, and more. So the floor is yours.
Okay. Well, thank you, Lucas, for the presentation. Thank you all for being here. It's a pleasure for me to be in this institute. Looking forward to learn a lot from all of you. The people I have already met seems quite amazing, and I think I will have a great time here. Today, I will go through the main results of six independent but related works that I decided to split in three different blocks. But I would like to start by talking about a big, well-known dilemma in our field, which, being myself a physicist, I have to acknowledge the success of statistical physics and spin models to explain the microscopic origin of phase transitions in ferromagnetic materials. This was almost 100 years ago. These models evolved very rapidly to incorporate disordered disordered systems, which led to much more rich phenomenology to explore in the context of condensed matter physics and in the early stages of neural networks. And well, in this context, in the 70s, the popular paper More is Different appeared, popularizing the idea that the complex system is more than the sum of the parts. But we had to wait almost 50 more years to witness the recognition from the Nobel to these theoretical contributions to complex systems, right? In fact, the success of the field has been astonishing. And thanks to the acquisition of data and the advances in computational power, we have advanced a lot. And this institute is a proof of this, right? So in the most extreme application of this, we have all these deep learning black boxes and so on that using linear algebra and training thousands of millions of parameters from just pure data are able to solve very complex and difficult problems, and also are able to create some decent art, like this painting that I created using the neural network DALI for the cover of my PhD thesis of my friend Benjamin Steiniger. So these examples illustrate the classic dilemma, right? So about the usage of minimal models to gain interpretation, or to use more complex algorithms to get much more predictive power, okay? If there is one phenomenon that actually has resisted well this avalanche of data and whose mathematics have always been one step beyond, is the process of synchronization, okay? So we are thinking in terms of the units of our system to have intrinsic rhythms, okay? So we are talking about oscillators. I would like to ask a question if someone, anybody in the audience can tell me who this guy is? Yes, it's Kuramoto, of course. This is a speech he gave for a conference in 2015 on his model. This speech is in YouTube, and I recommend it to watch it because it's very inspiring. He talks about the fate of his model and the origins and so on. And well, probably most of you know this model, right? Kuramoto model is basically the minimal model of synchronization, okay? It describes, using a couple set of differential first order equations, the evolution of oscillators that have only one variable, the phase, or the angle in the circle. So the dynamics has these two parts. The first part is the intrinsic frequency of the oscillators, and the second part is the interaction with the rest. Kuramoto defined this complex order parameter, and working in the mean field problem, meaning that he assumed all-to-all interactions. He was actually able, using a very original self-consistent analysis, to show that this model had a phase transition for the order parameter at a critical coupling, a critical value of the coupling strength, controlled by the distribution of the frequencies. This model was somehow an abstraction. It didn't represent anything. That's why when this very nice paper from Percolet and colleagues showing that the Kuramoto model was explaining the dynamics of coupled Josephson arrays, Josephson junction, sorry, Kuramoto wrote to Strogatz the following. I was surprised and really delighted. I didn't have the slightest idea that my simple model could ever find any example in real physical systems. But this was not all, okay? So thanks to pioneering works of people like Gianluca and Gonzalo, Roberta and Fernando and so on, that studied actually the problem of mutual synchronization in the quantum realm, this allowed later to show that actually the classical Kuramoto model could emerge to explain the the transitions to entanglement in isolated quantum systems. Okay, this model also can be emerges when one studies the dynamics of decentralized power grids, and also it can be shown that it can be used to explain the dynamics of much more complex neuronal models of neuronal dynamics. So in this sense, this model to me is like an effective theory of the emergence of temporal order in the universe. Okay, and it's a true milestone of theoretical physics of complex systems. So during the last decades of the last century, this model became a paradigm in nonlinear dynamics and statistical physics, and many variations of the model were studied, many phenomena was discovered. But if there is one ingredient that can explain this growth in the number of citations of the original model in time, is the incorporation of the complex structure in the problem, okay? Meaning that you don't have an all-to-all network here. Mathematicians knew a lot of properties of these objects, the graphs, and they were studying them a lot, but little was known about how these complex structures affect the dynamical processes on top of them, right? So in the change of century, a few papers came out that now are classics in the field, incorporating ideas from sociologists to model complex interaction patterns like long-range interactions or very heterogeneous degree distributions. And just in the following years, a lot of phenomena was discovered in like chimera states due to the interplay of structure and the dynamics, right? The first approximations to the threshold in complex networks arrived, also some interesting connections between communities, detection and synchronization. In parallel, the problem in the mean field world kept its course. And we had this amazing review in 2005, but only 3 years later, this well-known paper from Ott and Antonsen arrived and revolutionized the field, because basically they show that the all these phase models could have a low dimensional reduction, exact reduction from this high dimensional system to a few coupled differential equations. I will not enter into this, but I recommend you to check this review from 2020 from Vic, that actually explains that these kind of ideas can be extended to much more complex dynamics. And basically this shows that the Kuramoto itself is an exact autoencoder, right? But I'm concerned about complex networks. So many discoveries were made, like the emergence of explosive transitions or chaotic transitions due to the interplay between the structure and the dynamics of the heterogeneous oscillators. And in the last decade, the problems of the community have shifted towards more applied contexts, like in problems regarding control and optimization of the synchronized state. And sorry, when I started my thesis, people was trying to add more complexity into the model, coupling this model with other dynamics, and studying different networks, like temporal networks, multi-layer, higher orders. But I became a bit obsessed with the minimal model, right? Because there were things that I didn't yet understand. So now we have a context to motivate a bit my research. And as I said, that now we have all this amount of data, but this data is not free of errors. It has it has imperfect information, but this uncertainty has not been incorporated to the modeling. Okay. Besides that, we know that empirical systems usually operate using only the centralized information. They cannot access to the global information of the system, and it's unknown how they can explore and optimize themselves to reach global synchronized states. Right. Also, the most existing results rely on these spectral and numerical black boxes that you will see now that hinder interpretation and control of what is happening there. Also, the Kuramoto model in arbitrary complex network remains unsolved, and what we have is just a collection of a lot of stories, but there is not a whole holistic theory explaining all the phenomena that can occur, even in this simple model, right? So what's the point on going further? So the questions we asked were if we could find some analytical results to describe this phenomena under conditions of uncertainty, and if these results could also reveal underlying mechanisms controlling the interplay between the structure and the dynamics, which is the key problem of complex systems in the end. So in the first part of results, I was working on this very simple problem relating structural constraints and dynamical range. Okay, this means how the structure of a network can bound the possible range of dynamics, how versatile is a network in terms of synchronized states, and in the context of my thesis, can we tackle this problem using noise and uncertainty? Of course, the relation between microscopic configurations and macroscopic observables is a fundamental question of statistical physics, and these ideas have been applied successfully to the context of network theory, for instance, in building null models of networks subject to different kinds of constraints, like in the exponential random graphs and so on. Also, in the context of oscillators, we have a lot of works that dealing with the inference of the structure from the dynamical response of the system. And in terms of modeling, noise and fluctuation have been incorporated into the dynamics, but neglecting the complex structure, which difficults the analytical treatment. So here in this first block, we propose some creative, but not rigorous strategies to tackle this in three different problems. The first problem is based in this work published in Chaos with my friends, Guillem Mosquera, Benjamin Steinegger, and my advisor, and where we wondered how a complex network amplified noise from the microscopic waves. Sorry, from the microscopic weights to the macroscopic concept of synchronization. Okay, this is motivated by two questions. One hand, if we can predict the critical range of a network, meaning that you have a single network with a fixed structure of links, and you just shake it a bit so that the intensity of the weights fluctuate, and how this uncertainty propagates to a macroscopic quantity, right? On the other hand, these analysis can provide us something that was not there, the notion of error bars to these critical predictions, okay? So yes, we are focused on this problem here, on this regime. To tackle this from an analytical approach, what we did was using the best known approximation of the critical threshold, that for the case of random allocated frequencies is given by the inverse of the, by the threshold of the all-to-all, is rescaled by the inverse of the largest eigenvalue of the GCC matrix. So basically, we want to understand the fluctuations of this guy when there is quantity disorder in the microscopic interactions. And the rigorous way to tackle this problem would be using random matrix theory and spectral theory. But things get very challenging, at least for me, when you have this complex structure. So we did a further approximation, and we were using what is called a heterogeneous mean field approximation for the weighted networks that gives the threshold. The threshold is given by the ratio of the strength moments, where the strength is just the sum of the intensity of the nodes. And when you have this guy here, you can actually apply a well-known standard method in experimental physics, that is propagation of uncertainty. And in first approximation for Gaussian uncorrelated noise, we were able to get analytical expressions for the mean of the threshold and the typical fluctuations, okay? And we validated this in synthetic and empirical networks, showing a good agreement basically when the initial approximation holds. Here you can see also a first interesting result, that is that the intensity of the noise already affects the mean of the threshold, right? Making it to decrease. This can be understood because adding this noise in the structure is like adding another source of uncertainty, another source of heterogeneity. And we know that this heterogeneity in the degree distribution makes the threshold lower. So this is an explanation for this, but it's a bit more interesting to look at the effect on the fluctuations. Okay, so in first approximation, we were able to get this scaling that tells us that the fluctuations scale with the square of the mean. And naively, one would expect that the fluctuations, since the mean decreases for heterogeneous networks, one would expect that the fluctuations also would follow this trend, right? But there is this purely structural factor here that can challenge or change this intuition. Using a null model of a regular random network, we were able to show to find a condition that tells us if a given network with some heterogeneity will have larger fluctuations than its regular counterpart. And we check this analytically in models in a scale-free network where you can control the exponent, meaning the heterogeneity, and also the size. And we saw a non-monotonous behavior here. Red means larger fluctuations and blue means smaller fluctuations, where actually the maximum was found at the value of 3, of the exponent 3. We validated this measuring the critical threshold in numerical simulations, and we found these non-monotonous behaviors again. This key insight from this part is that this analytical approach provides the idea of confidence intervals for critical predictions, and there is this non-monotonous behavior of critical range depending on the network heterogeneity. This might be quite particularly relevant because we know that these kind of networks are very ubiquitous in nature, right? It's quite surprising that we found this. There are a lot of limitations of this. We were not able to understand the role of clustering, modularity, and other networks effects. Actually, I did some simulations, and there is also a monotonous behavior with clustering, pointing to some specific structures that maximize this range. What about negative interaction or correlated noise? This can also make the picture more complicated. And of course, a spectral approach is required for a more rigorous treatment, but this looks difficult. In any case, this was a first step towards a theory of uncertainty propagation in network dynamics. Let's go to the second work. This is based on this published paper in Physical River Research in collaboration with Sebastian Skardal, Dan Taylor, and my advisor, Alex Arenas. Here, we move from the critical threshold to the synchronized regime and ask a similar but related question. How do different types of interactions, here we consider pairwise and higher orders, affect the optimization and dynamical range of synchron? This question was motivated by recent evidence in neuronal systems where this higher order interaction seems to play an important role. And well, to tackle this problem in an easy way, we focus on a particular class of networks, the simplicial complexes, meaning that the triangles are constrained to be where the links between the three nodes exist. And the key point was to introduce this idea of with the parameter alpha, that we could balance the strength of pairwise and higher order interactions, keeping the overall strength conserved. Okay, so we work here with a Kuramoto model with a higher order three-body term. The choice of this term actually doesn't matter. You could take other choices here and the results would be the same. And we have this parametrization with alpha, right? So since we are interested in optimization and in the synchronized state, we can assume that there is phase locking. The phase differences between the phases are small, so we can linearize the system and work with the Laplacian system. But this Laplacian is now a composite Laplacian depending on both the pairwise structure and the triangle structure. In this linearized system, we can actually apply what is known as the synchrony aligned framework and solve this system using the pseudo-inverse of the Laplacian. We have to use the pseudo-inverse because the Laplacian is not invertible if it's connected. And yes, we did some experiments on geometric random networks motivated by this brain evidence in two different scenarios. So considering only pairwise interactions, but also the case with higher order interactions. And we studied two problems, right? One, where we allocated the frequencies randomly, and one where we just align the frequencies with the largest eigenvector associated with the largest eigenvalue that leads to optimal synchronization. Here you can see in blue that when the higher order interaction are activated, means that you have a better optimal synchronization and a worse random synchronization, meaning that there is a benefit in the dynamical range due to these higher order interactions. Skardal was able to derive this exact result relating the variance of the spectra of the Laplacian with the moments of the Dirichlet distribution and the moments of the triangle distribution. Ernesto Estrada, who was a jury in my thesis, told me that this, this result was already derived by a mathematician. I forgot the name, but as Javi told me, everything has been thought by a Greek guy and done by a Russian, so probably he was Russian. But whatever, we continued and actually, sorry. And then we checked this theory in numerical experiments of this spectral object, seeing that actually the spectrum was broadening when you turn on these higher order interactions. And this could be explained because the variance in the triangle distribution is always larger than the variance in the degree distribution, at least for this kind of networks. So here, this composite Laplacian framework allow us to analyze this interplay between the structure frequencies and different types of interactions. We unveiled that the mechanism, what we called this spectrum broadening, responsible to optimize synchronization and to increase the overall dynamical range in the presence of these three-body interactions. Limitations, yes, we only focus on simplicity and complexes. And it was recently shown that actually when you work with random hypergraphs, the trend can be reversed. So depending on the type of networks or structure you have, things can change. But at least for these simplicial complexes, this works very robustly. And in any case, this was the first work analyzing the optimal properties of seeing in the presence of higher order interactions. Let me go just very rapidly to this third problem of this first part. This is based on this work published in PRE with Albert Diaz-Aguilera and Alex Arenas, where the question we asked here was if networks with different connectivity patterns can generate the same synchronization dynamics behaviors only by weight tuning mechanism without altering the underlying structure. So we are trying to map the whole synchronization curve, but we were very ambitious, but we didn't know much back then. And to tackle this, yes, we have seen that there are like different spectral objects that emerge, like the adjacency matrix in the critical threshold or the Laplacian object in the synchronized regime, but we didn't know which was the objective function to optimize these weights in the mapping problem, right? So what we did again was chose an heuristic. Here we extend what is known as the local mean field approximation of synchronization that relates the local mean field of the node with the global mean field through the strength of the node. And here we extend this idea to higher orders, to meaning in network neighborhoods. So at first order is just means preserving the overall strength in the nodes, and second order preserving also the overall strength to first neighbors and so on, right? Once we have these constraints, we can choose an objective function to optimize this, subject that the weights are always positive. In our case, we restricted this, and use a simple method of Lagrange multiplier to find analytical solutions for the weights in this mapping problem. Results. For the local transformation, where basically means that you allocate the weights homogeneously in the available links of the target network, we can see what we were expecting, that the mapping was very good in the linear regime, but it failed dramatically around the critical threshold. No? So according to our theory, we could extend this to first order, and we also get an analytical approximation for this, and we saw that the mapping indeed improved, but there were still non-vanishing errors around the threshold. We could actually explain this because there is some intrinsic limitation in this kind of mapping between homogeneous and heterogeneous networks, in the sense that you cannot fake the hubs by just tuning the weights in a way to satisfy this constraint. So it doesn't matter to go to higher orders because even here it's not satisfied. So this was like a very small step towards this theory of functional control of oscillator networks. Our heuristic approach reveals the advantage of heterogeneous networks, somehow reminiscent to what we found in the first problem. But there were a lot of limitations also here. How you introduce other network effects, what about negative interactions, and how do we approach this problem by exact means, no? So some interesting work in this line arrive later, like for instance, in systems of diffusion reaction diffusion systems, and also in the Kuramoto model itself, but only restrict to the phase locking regime. And if you realize, we have only used information from the structure, but we could also exploit information from the dynamics, from the frequencies of the oscillators. The question is, which are the good constraints to solve this, which are the exact decentralized constraints. And this leads me to the second part, where I will explain that the answer was actually pretty simple. And I will talk about this geometric unfolding of synchronization dynamics. We have seen that this synchronized state captures well this interplay between the structure and dynamics in this problem. And we have seen that the solution is a spectral black box. It's difficult to optimize to understand how microscopic interactions affect this spectral object. So the question is, which are the local mechanisms governing this synchronized state? How do networks optimize global synchronization in decentralized contexts? Basically, what we wanted to do is an alternative route to a spectral problem. And I will present now some formal results on the expansions, the convergence analysis, and very short applications. So this is based on this paper published in Chaos with Skardal and Alex. And the main problem, after some simplifications, is basically to solve this linear system, where you have this Laplacian object here, but without using the pseudo-inverse. So since this Laplacian is not invertible, it means that you cannot actually do this geometric expansion here. But what we could prove is that when there are some conditions on the structure, meaning that the network is connected and not bipartite, so there are not nodes connecting only to the other nodes, and you multiply this object to a given vector, in our case, a frequency vector with zero mean, then this expansion converges. But it's not guaranteed that it will converge to the solution with the minimal norm, so we need to make a correction to each term to actually ensure that it converges to the one of minimal norm, that is the one we are interested. And what this means, what does it mean? It basically is a Taylor expansion of the synchronized state in terms of local information, first order information, second order information, and so on. So the answer was indeed very simple. We could check that there is a fast convergence of this expansion for random local Ether-like networks, scale-free or other ranges, and indeed, yes, these are the exact decentralized constraints in the synchronized regime, but they can also be extended to the nonlinear regime via what is known the collective coordinates ansets. So what do you do with this kind of expansions? You understand how the truncation works. And what about the mean square error? Using the same tools that we did use in the proofs, we could actually show that the mean square error scales with the second largest eigenvalue of the normalized adjacency matrix, which is close to one if the network is very sparse, very correlated, and it goes to zero if the network is random, locality-like, or very dense, right? So we could check this prediction tuning different effects of the networks, seeing a perfect match for high truncation order. And another question you can ask is, what about the error in the modulus? Okay, and here you have to realize that actually this second largest eigenvalue can be of different sign, so it can be positive or negative depending on the network properties. So what does this mean? This means that the type of convergence that we can get are actually equivalent to the solutions, so the decays of a damped harmonic oscillator. This means that if a network is very bipartite and or have negative correlations within connected nodes, this leads to an underdamped decay in this geometric expansion. Instead, if the network is very modular or has positive correlations, this leads to an overdamped decay in the expansion. And if the network is very random-like or there are no correlations, this is equivalent to having a critically damped regime. So in this sense, there is somehow an effective geometry that emerges from the interplay between the frequencies and the structure and tell us that there are some convergence decays that you cannot actually get by some specific network. And this suggests that there could be a spectral theory that could be used to build null models for measuring associativity in a given network, which is an interesting idea that we did not follow here. Instead, we went more through direct applications, like finding this local approximation of synchrony, truncating this expansion to first neighbors, which was very naive, but actually was able to explain many results that were not known or only known numerically, like the positive effect of positive frequency degree correlation in synchrony, or the fact that degree heterogeneity actually reduces synchrony in this linear regime, and so on, right? Another application, very small, it was like trying to compute the effect of adding or removing a single link on the synchronization, right? So there were some existing results based on first-order perturbation theory that basically tell nothing, because you don't understand nothing from this kind of expression here. So now we have a theory that can tackle the same problem using just local information, We could do this also for undirected and directed links. And this simple theory actually led us to predict the Bryce paradox in directed networks, showing that when you have a random directed network, more or less 1/4 of the links actually lead to the effect of when you add a link, the synchrony decreases, or when you remove a link, the synchrony increases. The final application of this formalism is what I like to call the synchronization bombs. This work has been finally accepted in communication physics and is done in collaboration with people from Zaragoza, Sergio Fassi and Jesús Gómez Gardeñez, Escardal and Arenas. And the idea here was to try to explain if there is a self-organized route to the emergence of explosive synchronization. This explosive synchronization is a well-understood phenomenon that emerges from the interplay between the structure and the dynamics, the correlating frequencies with degrees and so on. And it's thought to have to play a key role in neuronal disease. The phenomenon theoretically is well understood, but actually all the works study this process by tuning a global parameter and seeing how the synchronization makes abrupt jumps in the order parameter. On the other hand, we have this process called explosive percolation that basically is a competitive percolation process driven by some local rules that actually make the giant component, the deformation of the giant component, to be delayed. And in the end, it jumps abruptly. So these are two different phenomena, but we wonder also if this we could have a theory that actually could join them. So what we did here was actually using this local rule based on optimizing synchronization using local information as a competitive percolation rule. So we made our network to grow using, at each time step, we were sampling some links and choosing the one that maximized this gain of synchronization. When the sampling was sufficiently high, we could actually see that synchronization explosions emerged by the addition of a single link in the system, even if the system was very large. We also saw, and it was quite expected, the emergence of these explosive structural fingerprints in the structure, like all these correlations that were already known to lead this to this explosive phenomenon, and also a delay of the percolation threshold. This can be understood also in terms of what is known now as percolation on feature-enriched problems, where you have some metadata on the percolation problem. Here, the metadata are the frequencies of the nodes. We could also find an analytical characterization of this model in the case of the Kuramoto system, finding a prediction for the backward and forward thresholds using what are known as the collective coordinate ansatz and again these Ott-Antonen ansatz, predicting actually what was the link that led to these explosions. And this theory allows us to find a very simple relation between percolation threshold and synchronization threshold that is quite surprising nothing more. Here we also extend this model to directed networks for different type of frequency distribution, so in some effects. And we could also see that there is a non-monotonous behavior with the sampling that can be explained by the local nature of the percolation process. So you need some noise or randomness in the process to actually find the optimal solution for the bomb. And we extend these bombs to chaotic oscillators and also to a model of cardiac pacemaker cells. And well, yeah, the key insights of this part is that this geometric unfolding allowed us to decompose the signal in spatial terms and to tackle decentralized problems by rigorous means. And we show some applications of the formalism being one of the special interest, this idea of a self-organized model of synchronization bombs. Open work in these bomb models is like, is there any implication in brain dynamics? Because I'm not sure. And can we design actually different rules leading to other macroscopic phenomena like chaos or waves and so on? With this, I conclude this part and I go very rapidly to the last part of the presentation. And I like this quote a lot by this guy. I found this in a book of quantum and chaos. But yeah, it's very nice. And you will see why it fits here. So I was working the last summer in 2021 on trying to solve these bombs using all these analytical answers and so on. When this paper came out by these people from Canada, where they were claiming that they have solved the Kuramoto model via algebraic means. Actually, this is not the case, but still, this solution they found is actually interesting to control different kind of phenomena like chimeras, waves, or and so on in networks of identical oscillators. But let me go a bit through this recent algebraic approach. It doesn't solve the Kuramoto model. What they did is adding just a complex imaginary part to this model. But then the phases become a complex variable. In this way, you can actually write this system is as a linear system with this matrix, with this operator here. But actually, if you unfold again the dynamics in the real and the imaginary part, you can see that in the real part, you get the Kuramoto model, but constrained to the relation of the amplitudes. And actually, these amplitudes are not equal. So this means that this is not the Kuramoto model, and also you get another constraint for the imaginary part. You can see that both models have similar properties, but they are not actually the same. And it's quite illustrative to understand that actually this route that the Canadian guys did was actually the reverse route that Kuramoto himself did when he derived his model from heuristic principles. So Kuramoto started with a couple system of Stewart-Landau oscillators, meaning that oscillators that had phase and amplitude, and he was working in the thermodynamic limit, considering an all-to-all coupling and a weakly coupled limit, meaning that there is a time scale separation between the relaxation to the limit cycle of each oscillator and the interaction with the rest. Then basically his model reduces again to the same linear model, which if you do these answers that the amplitudes are constant and forget about the imaginary part, you reach the Kuramoto model. So it's just the reverse way, just a few years later. And actually this linear model was already proposed by Roberts in the 2008, and it's quite a mystery because this paper is super nice, and it explains that this linear model has a transition from incoherence to full phase locking at some critical value of the coupling strength. But Roberts quit or died after publishing this paper, so it's just stopped there. And the paper got a bit forgotten because it was the same year that the Ott-Anderson paper appeared, and nobody just cared about it. And actually, this model has the analogous form of the equation that Strogatz and Mirollo derive for the stability of the incoherent state, but with a coupling that is twice the coupling. What this means is that actually we can tackle the problem of finding the critical threshold in the Kuramoto model using a linear algebra. And basically, it reduces to finding the spectral transitions in a non-Hermitian non-Hermitian matrix, which is given by this first term, where you have the frequencies of the oscillators, and this second term, where you have the adjacency matrix. We did a proof of concept here using what is known as a configuration model, so the rank one reduction of the model. You only have information of the degrees, and then basically you want to solve. You want to find where some eigenvalue of this system actually pops out to the real axis, and you can solve this characteristic equation using some Maastricht determinant lemma. And again, assuming no correlations between the frequencies and degrees and large size, we could actually recover the critical threshold in the heterogeneous mean field case without using a self-consistent analysis, just exploiting the spectral properties of this object. Basically finding the exceptional point of this kind of matrix. This can be extended to higher rank models, but I want to comment some interesting implications of the results. So, and of the model itself, when you work again with only homogeneous oscillators, actually you can see that you get to this equation with X complex, and basically the communicability matrix, well-known matrix in complex network, actually emerges from the dynamics of this homogeneous complex oscillators, and which can be again unfolded in this geometric space. And this equation is again equivalent to the equation we were working with, linear equation in the real regime. So now we have two linear systems that can inform us about the properties of synchronization, either in the critical threshold or in the synchronized regime. And well, there is some work in progress in this line. My friend Giulio Burgio is extending this algebraic shortcut to find the onset of synchrony in the presence of both pairwise and higher order interactions. this method can also be used to find a precise numerical estimation of the onset in the presence of frequency correlations and for arbitrary network structures. And the interesting conjectures that emerge from this analysis are probably the most beautiful ones of my thesis. And they are not done, they are unsolved, but I hope someone will tackle them at some point. And it's about if we can classify actually all these synchronization transitions that emerge in the Kuramoto model, like explosive, chaotic, wavy transitions, using these non-Hermitian random matrices and higher order rank models. And also, if we could classify the networks themselves in terms of the accessible synchronized transitions, in somehow obtaining like the signatures of complex networks, the flavor, dynamical flavor that a given network has. This was just to conclude. So what I have presented here today is just a collection of a few analytical methods to work in this problem of synchronization in complex networks under uncertainty. And the main strength, I would say, that is the high interpretability and mechanistic insights that we can gain from this structure and dynamics interplay from this decentralized perspective. And of course, the drawback is that the more simplifications and analytical approximations you make, the less mathematical rigor you have and less immediate applications there are in empirical systems. There were some lines of future work. One would be to advance towards this general theory of network synchronization built from geometric and spectral principles, but I don't recommend this for your mental health. But well, the second one would be to shift towards more detailed and realistic models of neural dynamics, but somehow I feel that this didn't fit me. And the third one was to exploit these minimal models of network dynamics to interpret and analyze underlying processes in deep learning algorithms. And that's what I will be doing here with Lucas, hopefully for these 2 years. So I would like to thank several people, particularly my advisor, Alex Arenas, this amazing mathematician, Scardal, my friends, Giulio Burgio and Benjamin Steiniger, and all the people from the Alepsis lab, and well, all my collaborators. And well, thank you all for your attention. That's all.
Thanks very much. I think I have to stop the recording now. For the questions, no? Oh, no, okay, sorry. I misunderstood the story. So thanks very much, Luis. What's the routine? First, we go to questions to the online audience.
If there is some.
So if anyone has a question, just unmute yourself and talk. If no, then here physically in the audience, do you have any questions, anybody?
I didn't understand something about your last part of the presentation, which is you talked about the rank of the network, but I didn't get what's the importance of the rank with regards to synchronization.
You mean here, right?
And later you commented that you have still to study higher ranks. And so
well,
you mentioned it.
The thing, there is no explicit relation between both things. It's just that when you work with this kind of low rank models, you could actually get some analytical results. And that's what you can do actually with this rank one model in this case. And yes, actually this idea comes from this paper that is called Exact Rank Reductions of Network Models. So all these network models that we know, like a stochastic low model, it has the rank of the number of communities, activity-driven hard rank two, degree-corrected models. All these rank-reduced models can actually be applied in the same theory. And in principle, you could get some analytical or semi-analytical expression for the threshold, or at least for finding one when one eigenvalue pops out from the imaginary axis, meaning that you find at least the value of the threshold in your low rank model. Okay. But there is no explicit relation between both things.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Any questions? in these extensions that you go to this complex phase,
yes,
to which extent you don't recover the same results than for the store and out oscillators? I mean, what's the difference between going to this complex phase and into that and working directly with the store and out oscillator from
there? Probably it's the working with the complex linear system. Actually, you are losing information if you that you would have you if you would work with the Stuart-Landau system.
So it's like in Stuart-Landau where you have deleted some nonlinear terms or something like that.
Yeah. It's as I said in the beginning of the presentation, I like to work with the minimal model of synchronization. So I'm not aware of a lot of analytical results solving the dynamics of the Stuart-Landau.
It's not simple. But what I mean is that if you go to the Kuramoto to simplify the things, and then you introduce an extra variable, and you get something which is similar to a Stuart-Landau, to which point you are not back to the very beginning.
Well, the thing is that
you have win on
it's not the very beginning, but it's in between, because if you stay here, you are working with a linear system somehow, and everything ends up just thinking about this kind of non-Hermitian random matrices. At least is how I understand this.
Now, in the Stuart-Landau model, there is it plays a critical role whether you couple, say, the real to the real or the real to the imaginary. So the cross-coupling plays a critical role in the dynamics. In here, how disappears here? This should not be possible here.
Probably this is not possible in the linear model, no. All the coupling is through the both at the same time.
You have already eliminated all the coupling when you go to the simplified
everything. Yes. Okay. But the Kuramoto model itself simplifies even more stuff. But it's about finding the right balance between phenomenology and analytical explainability.
In the Kuramoto model, which is the phase model, there are a lot of unsynchronized states, which all of them become unstable all of a sudden, say in the old world coupling operations. So you have the uniform distributed unsynchronized state, and the ones that are not uniform, all of them become unstable all of a sudden when there is the transition. But that's not the case in the Stuart-Landau model, and that's not the case if you go to a phase model which is of a higher order. In these cases, you still get, I guess, all the unstable, all the unsynchronized solutions getting unstable simultaneously.
And it's even worse because the transition goes to a state where there is full phase locking. So the transition.
So you go directly from unsynchronized to full phase.
Yeah, but the oscillators become phase locked in the whole circle.
That's sharp.
But actually, if you look at the curve, it doesn't look very sharp, but because it starts with the phase locking around the whole circle. But yeah, it's very very simple model.
Okay.
So I have one or two.
Thanks for the talk, Luis. So in the first part, when you address uncertainty, like making a perturbation in the links, noise or quenched noise, or something like this. So I wonder, I mean, from a dynamical point of view, when you have a dynamical system and you perturb the parameters of the system, which is more or less what you do here, no? It's perturbing this adjacency matrix in some way, and you look at the asymptotic behavior of the system. In this case, it's the phase transition, but it's in the dynamical system is like, well, the stability of the fixed point and things like this. So this is called structural stability in the jargon of dynamical systems, and there's a tradition there. Have you considered this approach to analyze this or to compare your results with that?
I have not considered this approach, and I think what I do sometimes in this part is an abuse of notation, in the sense that I talk about noise, but what I am dealing is with quench disorder. So I'm thinking about different. So the network has only one is in one particular state with some quench disorder. And I am studying the fluctuations of an ensemble of networks with this kind of disorder. I don't see it as a dynamical process itself, the fluctuations.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. I mean, that's why, yeah, points done is fine. But okay, maybe we can discuss
Later. Yeah, but no, I didn't have it.
Yeah, you can approach this problem from a from a dynamical systems angle, where you are perturbing the parameters of the of your system, not the initial condition, let's say, of the unit. And then my other question is about this mysterious concept of geometric unfolding. I mean, could you elaborate more about, like, from a conceptual point of view, what you want to do with that? I mean, forgetting the equations, and can you give us, like, a picture of what is this geometric unfolding? And I mean, is it? Can it be like a new sort of decomposition theory or a mathematical decomposition theory, or is it just some heuristic approach or general?
It's not heuristic, it's exact. It's just an expansion of the synchronized state in this domain that is made by these bases of increasing neighborhoods. So to me, it's very intuitive. Like, you have information that you can truncate at a given order, meaning that you can truncate it at a given neighborhood of the network. This idea has been used in different problems, like from computing the CAD centralities and other measures, but it wasn't actually applied in this context of synchrony. And yes, actually gives this decomposition in this spatial domain, where most of the community was working always in the decomposition in the spectral domain. So now you have this dual decomposition of the system that I think it can be beneficial, because truncating in the spectral domain always for sure give you the best low rank truncation, but it's like a PCA, right? Here you have another domain when you can actually truncate in the physical domain of the network.
And also, to some extent, in real complex networks, you know that it is enough for you to know the neighbors of your neighbors. Let's say at step three, you more or less have the whole network.
Yes.
So you can, is there an effective like cutoff in the number of terms in this unfolding that you need to fully describe what you want to describe in empirical networks? Because in, let's say in lattices, maybe you need to do
it's
all the terms, but in
Yes, exactly. But the thing is that for these local iterator-like networks, you can truncate it fast. When the network has this spatial distribution like lattices or very correlated effects, you can't. And actually, it's interesting because there is some kind of trade-off. When you can truncate fast in the spectral domain, you cannot truncate it fast here. So there is some kind of uncertainty bound in how you can truncate both expansions, more or less. That would be the idea.
Thank you. Anything else? Well, if not, let's thank Luis again.
Thanks.